Revelation chapter 3, verse 1. And to the angel of the church in Sardis write. So at the time Jesus spoke these words to John, the ancient city of Sardis had seen its best days and had started to decline. Yet it was a wealthy city, situated at the junction of several important roads and trade routes. And the connection between Sardis and money, easy money, was well known in the ancient world. And this city was also a city well known for its softness and luxury. It had a well-deserved reputation for apathy and immorality. In Sardis, there was a large, stately temple to the mother goddess Cybele. And from the ruins of that temple, we can see that its main columns were 60 feet or 20 meters high and more than 6 feet in diameter. And this mother goddess was honored and worshipped with all kinds of sexual immorality and impurity. And so the combination of easy money and loose moral environment made the people of Sardis notoriously soft and pleasure-loving. And so the great characteristic of Sardis was that even on pagan lips, Sardis was a name of contempt. Its people were notoriously loose-living, notoriously pleasure and luxury-loving. Sardis was a city of the decadence. Verse 1. These things says he who has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. So as Jesus described himself, he used terms that emphasize his character as the master of every spiritual power and authority. The repetition of the number seven helped indicate this because seven is the number of completeness in the Bible. Therefore, Jesus holds the fullness of the Spirit of God and the fullness of the church. And Jesus has the fullness of the Holy Spirit in himself, and he has the Holy Spirit and fullness to give to the church. And Jesus also has the fullness of the church in his hand. We know the seven stars represent the churches because of what Jesus said in Revelation chapter 1, verse 20, where he says, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. And through these letters, when Jesus speaks of the angels of the seven churches, he's speaking not to one individual, but to the entire church through that individual. Right, verse 1. I know your works, that you have a name, that you are alive. So as Jesus said to each church, he also said to Sardis, what a church is and what a church does is never hidden from Jesus. And Jesus knew the church at Sardis had a name, that is a reputation of life and vitality. If you looked at the church of Sardis, you would see signs of life and vitality. In the church of Sardis, like the city of Sardis, everything seemed alive and good. All right, and finishing verse 1. But you are dead. So despite their reputation of life, Jesus saw them for what they really were. But you are dead is going to show that a good reputation is no guarantee of true spiritual character. Despite their good appearance, Jesus saw them as dead. And this indicates no struggle, no fight, no persecution. It wasn't that the church at Sardis was losing the battle. A dead body has lost the battle, and the fight seems over. In this letter, Jesus didn't encourage the Christians in Sardis to stand strong against persecution or false doctrine, probably because there simply wasn't a significant danger of these things in Sardis. Being dead, the church in Sardis presented no significant threat to Satan's domain, so it wasn't worth attacking. So Sardis was a perfect model of inoffensive Christianity. Their problem was not scandalous wickedness, but a decent death. Their image said alive, but in substance they were dead. All right, verses 2 through 4. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die, for I have not found your works perfect before God. Remember, therefore, how you have received and heard, hold fast and repent. Therefore, if you will not watch, I will come upon you as a thief, and you will not know what hour I will come upon you. You have a few names even in Sardis who have not defiled their garments, but they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. So this first instruction from Jesus told them they need to examine and protect, strengthening what they have. The things which remain are going to tell us that though the spiritual condition of the church of Sardis was bad, it wasn't hopeless. Spiritually, there were things which remained that could be strengthened. Jesus had not given up on them, and though it was late, it was not too late. So in its history, the city of Sardis was easily conquered twice before. It wasn't that the attacking armies overwhelmed Sardis, but because overconfidence made them stop being watchful, the spiritual state of the church in Sardis was a reflection of the city's historical character. And I have not found your works perfect before God is going to show that their works, though present, had not measured up to God's standard. The presence of works is not enough because God requires a particular intent and purpose in all of our works. They should be done with a heart and in a manner that show them to be perfect before God. And so they performed duties of all kinds, but not duty completely. They were constantly beginning, but never brought anything to a proper end. And what they must do was to remember how they first received and heard the word of God. Then they must hold fast to those things and repent by turning and restoring the gospel and apostolic doctrine to authority over their lives. And Paul described in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13, the kind of reception of the word they needed to remember. For this reason, we also thank God without ceasing, because when you received the word of God, which you heard from us, you welcomed it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth, the word of God, which also effectively works in you who believe. So Jesus warned them of the great danger in failing to watch. If they ignored his command to be watchful, then Jesus would come upon them as a thief at a time completely unexpected. So how would Jesus come upon them? He could come in the sense of bringing immediate judgment, or he could come in the sense of his coming at the rapture of the church in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16 and 17. Which says, "For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout and the voice of an archangel and the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up," harpazo or raptured, "together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord." So used in either sense, it showed that he might come suddenly and unannounced, so they must be watchful. And so even among the dead Christians in Sardis, there was a faithful remnant, but only a few names. In Pergamos, in chapter 2, verse 14, and in Thyatira, in chapter 2, verse 20, there were a few bad among the good. In Sardis, there were a few good among the bad. So even in Sardis, even is going to show that in some ways, it was remarkable that there were a few names still faithful to the Lord. It may have been remarkable because of the city's notoriously immoral reputation. Even in a city that wicked, some among the Christians had not defiled themselves by joining in sin. And Jesus referred to defiled garments because in the heathen worship of the day, the pagan gods could not be approached with dirty clothes. So the analogy works for the worship of Jesus because he gives his people white garments. And Jesus also promised that these pure ones would walk with me, Jesus. This picture of close fellowship and friendship is seen in Enoch, who walked with God and he was not, for God took him, in Genesis 5, verse 24. And of course, the garments Jesus gives are always white. Sardis was a church that was dead because of sinful compromise, so they needed to receive and walk in the pure white garment that Jesus gives. White was also the color of triumph to the Romans, so the white garment spoke of the believer's ultimate triumph in Jesus. So walk with me. This is the greatest reward Jesus can give his followers. The Christians in Sardis who forsook the sinful compromise of their city would be rewarded with a closer, more intimate walk with Jesus. This reward is ultimately a better motivator than the fear of punishment or ruin from our sin. And so the pure can have greater intimacy with God, not because they've earned it, but because they are simply more interested in the things of God. God promises to reward that interest. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 8, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." Verse 5, "He who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments, and I will not blot his name out from the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels." So Jesus identified the overcomers with those few names who had not defiled their garments. In chapter 3, verse 4, these overcomers would wear white garments received from Jesus. The difference between the dead majority with imperfect works, but they had a good reputation, and the few names who pleased God with purity, and the closeness with Jesus that is always related to purity, the deadness and spiritual facade of most of the Christians in Sardis was related to their impure lives, their embrace of the impurity and sin of the world around them. It's hard to say if the deadness came before the impurity or the impurity came before the deadness, but they were surely related. And Jesus explained the absolute necessity of this being clothed by God with his garments of purity and righteousness in his parable of the wedding feast in Matthew 22, verses 11 through 14, which says, "But when the king came in to see the guests, he saw a man there who did not have on a wedding garment. So he said to him, 'Friend, how did you come in here without a wedding garment?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the servants, 'Bind him hand and foot, take him away, and cast him into outer darkness. And there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth, for many are called, but few are chosen.'" And so real righteousness is receiving God's covering instead of trying to cover ourselves. Adam and Eve tried to cover their own sin in Genesis chapter 3, verse 7, where it says, "Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings." But God provided them with a covering that came from sacrifice. in Genesis chapter 3, verse 21. Also, for Adam and his wife, the Lord God made tunics of skin and clothed them, right? Animal skins. And so by this, I will not blot out his name from the book of life. The overcomers were assured of their heavenly citizenship. In the ancient world, death or criminal conviction could blot out the name of an ancient citizen from the city's book of the living, which was the city register. And so in ancient times, cities kept a register of their citizens. When a man died, his name was removed from the register. The risen Christ is saying that if we wish to remain on the roll of the citizens of God, we must keep our faith flamingly alive. And so blot out his name from the book of life. Does this mean that someone can lose their salvation? That someone is saved one day, their name is in the book of life, and another day they've fallen away and their name has been blotted out from the book of life? So we need to see the context here in Revelation chapter 3, verse 5. The focus is assurance. So we should not think that the names are being constantly erased and then rewritten. The focus here is not the idea that Jesus sits in heaven with a busy eraser. At the same time, we should carefully consider what the Word has to say about the book of life. So there is a book of life, and it will be opened and referenced on the day of judgment. This means that the book of life is real and will be read. And Revelation 20, verse 12 will say, "And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books." So there is a book of life, and it determines if we go to heaven or hell. This means that the book of life is important. And Revelation 20, verse 15 will say, "And anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire." So there's a book of life, and knowing our names are written there should bring us great joy. Luke chapter 10, verse 20 will say, "Nevertheless, do not rejoice in this, that the spirits are subject to you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven." So this book of life, there are five different references to people being blotted out of that book. This means that the idea of being blotted out of the book of life should be taken seriously. Perhaps it is only a symbol and that person's name was never there to begin with. Even if that is the case, the Lord still wants us to take it seriously, because there are some who by every human appearance are saved, yet will not be in heaven. And Moses said to the Lord in Exodus 32, verse 32, "Yet now, if you will forgive their sin, but if not, I pray, blot me out of your book which you have written." In Exodus 32, verse 33, "And the Lord said to Moses, whoever has sinned against me, I will blot him out of my book." In Psalm 69, verse 28, "Let them be blotted out of the book of the living and not be written with the righteous." Revelation chapter 3, verse 5, "He who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments, and I will not blot his name out of the from the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before the angels." And Revelation 22, verse 19, where it says, "And anyone takes away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part from the book of life, from the holy city, and from the things which are written in this book." And so a good example of how we should take this warning seriously is the life of a man named Charles Templeton. A generation ago, he was deeply involved in the foundations of Youth for Christ and impacted the nation for Jesus. Many people received Jesus at his meetings, and Mr. Templeton was an associate with Billy Graham in the early years. Nevertheless, he renounced his belief in Jesus, renounced even his belief in God, and said he was an atheist. Charles Templeton totally renounced his early confessions of faith and wanted to rescue the people that he once brought to Jesus. So obviously this man, in his present apostate state, is not going to heaven and did not want to. One may long debate if he was ever saved or if he ever lost his salvation, but at the end of the debate, there are two conclusions. First, at one time, by all human appearance, he was saved. Second, he didn't honor the warnings of the Bible telling us to keep walking, to keep trusting, and to keep persevering in the faith. And so in the genealogies of the Bible, there are two books mentioned, the book of the generation of Adam in Genesis chapter 5, verse 1, and the book of the generation of Jesus Christ in Matthew chapter 1, verse 1. So being born of Adam doesn't guarantee that our name is written in the book of life. Being born again, born of Jesus Christ, gives us that assurance. And so I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. So this is an amazing promise. It simply makes sense that we should be willing to confess the name of Jesus, but it is amazing that he would not be ashamed to confess us. So it's important for us to accept Jesus, but it's far more important to know if Jesus accepts us. Verse 6, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. So we must all hear what the Spirit says to the church at Sardis. It's easy to drift in sleepy apathy toward spiritual death, especially when you got a good reputation. Still, there is always hope for the dead church because Jesus knows how to raise the dead. And Sardis teaches us that we must be aware of our success. The city was wealthy and knew easy living, but it made them soft and spoiled. And Sardis also teaches us that we should be watchful at our strongest points. And Sardis thought it was unconquerable, and so it was conquered. Where we say, I would never do that, is the exact place that we must guard against. Verse 7, and to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write. So Philadelphia, the name means brotherly love, and this city was the youngest of the seven cities and was originally founded as a missionary outpost for Hellenism, the culture of ancient Greece. And the original purpose behind this key city was to make it a center for spreading Greek language, culture, and manners through the Asian provinces. And so Philadelphia had been built with a deliberate intention that it might become a missionary city. Beyond Philadelphia lay the wilds of Phrygia and the barbarous tribes. It was intended that the function of Philadelphia should be to spread the Greek language, the Greek way of life, the Greek civilization throughout the regions beyond. And it was a prosperous city. Philadelphia commanded one of the greatest highways in the world, the highway which led from Europe to the east. Philadelphia was the gateway from one continent to another. And this city was also known for beautiful buildings. It was called the Little Athens, and her earthquakes, which required frequent evacuations. All right, verse 7. These things says he who is holy, he who is true, he who has the key of David, he who opens and no one shuts, and shuts and no one opens. So Jesus reminded the church in Philadelphia that he was holy and true. These do not describe tendencies within Jesus, but it's his very being. And they also show that Jesus is Yahweh because he alone is holy in the absolute sense. There are two ancient Greek words that we might translate true. One means true and not false. The other means true and not fake. The ancient Greek word used here for true, alethinos, is the second, with the idea of a real or genuine. So Jesus is true in all of who he is. He is the real God and the real man. So Jesus showed that he's also the keeper of the keys and doors. In this quotation from Isaiah 22, verse 20 through 23, which will say, and it shall be in that day that I will call my servant Eliakim, the son of Hilkiah, and I will clothe him with your robe and strengthen him with your belt, and I will commit your responsibility into his hand, and he shall be a father to the inhabitants of Jerusalem and to the house of Judah. The key of the house of David I will lay on his shoulder, so he shall open and no one shall shut, and he shall shut and no one shall open. And I will fasten him as a peg in a secure place, and he will become a glorious throne to his father's house. So Jesus expressed his power and authority, especially to admit and exclude. Verse 8, I know your works. See, I have set before you an open door, and no one can shut it. For you have a little strength, have kept my word, and have not denied my name. And so Jesus said this to each of the seven churches, I know your works. The church at Philadelphia had served God well in different difficult circumstances, and Jesus knew it. And the church in Philadelphia had an open door set before them. Often an open door speaks of evangelistic opportunity. You can look at 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 9, which will say, for a great and effective door has opened to me, and there are many adversaries. In 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 12, furthermore, when I came to Troas to preach Christ's gospel, and a door was opened to me by the Lord. In Colossians chapter 4, verse 3, meanwhile, praying also for us that God would open to us a door for the word to speak the mystery of Christ, for which I am also in chains. So Jesus told them he had opened the door of evangelistic opportunity, and they must go through that door in faith. So in its history, Philadelphia had a great evangelistic calling. The city had a mission of spreading Greek culture and language throughout that whole region. Now Jesus opened the door for the Christians in Philadelphia to spread the culture of his kingdom throughout that whole region. And Jesus told them to see that they had this open door. Sometimes God sets an open door of evangelistic opportunity in front of us, but we don't see it. And so once we see this open door, we then have to walk through it. God wants us to take every evangelistic opportunity that he gives us. And there may be another sense to this open door. It seems Christians in Philadelphia were excluded from the synagogue in Revelation chapter 3, verse 9. And so the open door may also speak of their opportunity to enter God's kingdom in contrast with the exclusion from the synagogue. And no one can shut it. The emphasis is on unhindered openness. There is nothing that can keep them from their access to this door. Since Jesus is the one, he's the one who opens and no one shuts and shuts and no one opens, he had the authority to keep this door open for the Christians in Philadelphia. So David could shut or open the kingdom of Israel to whom he pleased. He was not bound to leave the kingdom even to his eldest son. He could choose whom he pleased to succeed him. And the kingdom of the gospel and the kingdom of heaven are at the disposal of Christ. And God opens doors for ministry and ministers today. And because Jesus has opened the door, he gets the glory for it. Neither wealth or influence, neither promotional schemes, nor the eloquence of the pulpit, nor the harmonies of its musicians can give it an effective ministry. The Lord alone has opened the door, and the Lord alone gives the increase. And so the term, a little strength, does not imply weakness, but real strength. They were weak enough to be strong in the Lord. We can be too strong or too big or too sure of ourselves for God to really use us. And so the church in Philadelphia had the poverty of spirit to know that they really needed God's strength. And so it's not a matter of great strength, not great ability, but great dependability. Samson had great ability, but poor dependability. You know, he had this great ability, right? But poor dependability on God. So a little strength faithfully used means more than much strength flashily and fitfully used. And the Apostle Paul was a great example of this dynamic of weakness and strength. God's strength was made evident in his weaknesses in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 7 through 10, which will say, "Unless I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, a messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I be exalted above measure. Concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord three times that it might depart from me. And he said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly, I will rather boast in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong.'" And so the church in Philadelphia was faithful to Jesus and his word. The idea behind "I have not denied my name" is not only that they expressed their allegiance to Jesus, but that they lived in a way that was faithful to the name and character of Jesus. So some churches that claim great faithfulness to the word of Jesus deny his name, his character. They represent the manner and style of Jesus as something very different from what the Bible shows. And you can just look at the features of the church in Philadelphia. They had evangelistic opportunity. I've set before you an open door. They had reliance on God. You have little strength. And they had faithfulness to Jesus. You have kept my word and have not denied my name. So in some ways, these features seem unspectacular. They should be commonplace among churches. Yet Jesus was completely pleased with this church. He had nothing negative to say to the church at Philadelphia. Take special notice of that. And the church of Philadelphia is commended for keeping the word of the Lord and not denying his name. Success in Christian work is not to be measured by any other standard of achievement. It is not rise in ecclesiastical position. It's not the number of new buildings which have been built through a man's ministry. It's not the crowds that flock to listen to any human voice. All these things are frequently used as yardsticks of success, but they are earthly and not heavenly measures. Verse 9 and 10. "Indeed, I will make those of the synagogue of Satan, who say they are Jews but are not, but lie, indeed I will make them come and worship before your feet, and to know that I have loved you. Because you have kept my command to persevere, I also will keep you from the hour of trial, which shall come upon the whole world, to test those who dwell on the earth." So apparently the Christians in Philadelphia were persecuted by Jewish people, the synagogue. However, these persecuting Jews were Jews in name only, who say they are Jews and are not, but lie. In fact, they had no spiritual connection to Abraham or to the people of faith. So in this, Jesus did not speak against all Jewish people. It would be entirely wrong to speak of the Jewish people as a whole as the synagogue of Satan, or those who say they are Jews and are not. Jesus spoke of this specific group of Jewish people in Philadelphia who persecuted the Christians during that period. So, "I will make them come and worship before your feet." So in this, Jesus promised that he would vindicate his people and make sure that their persecutors recognized that they were wrong and that Jesus and his followers were right. The idea is a vindication before a self-righteous spiritual persecutors. God promised that the church in Philadelphia would be vindicated before their persecutors. And God promised Israel that Gentiles would honor them and acknowledge their God in Isaiah 45, verse 14. Now the tables are somewhat turned, and these Jewish people will play a role of the heathen and acknowledge that the church is the Israel of God. And so in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verses 24 and 25, we'll speak of unbelievers falling down in the midst of Christians to worship God. This establishes that it wasn't Christians who were being worshipped, but God was worshipped in the presence of Christians. And so as those who were once their enemies worshipped alongside of them, they were destroyed as enemies. They now knew that Jesus had loved these people they once persecuted. The best way to destroy the enemies of the gospel is to pray that God would change them into friends. And persecuted people often long for justice against their persecutors. In Revelation chapter 6, verse 10, we see the martyrs in heaven, where it says, "And they cried with a loud voice, saying, How long, O Lord, holy and true, until you judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth?" So a passage from the second century Christian is going to show this. What sight shall wake my wonder, what my laughter, my joy, and exultation, as I see all those kings, those great kings, groaning in the depths of darkness, and the magistrates who persecuted in the name of Jesus, liquefying in fiercer flames, and they kindled in their rage against the Christians. So Jesus also promised them protection from the hour of trial coming on the whole world. Most Bible scholars see this hour of trial as a prophetic reference to the messianic woes, the great tribulation which precedes Jesus' earthly kingdom. And Jesus promised to keep these Christians from that hour of trial. And so the test is directed against all those who dwell on the earth, to test those who dwell on the earth, right? This phrase is used 9 times in the book of Revelation, and it's going to speak of those who are not saved in Jesus. Revelation chapter 17, verse 8 will make the term synonymous with the lost, where it says, "And those who dwell on the earth will marvel, whose names are not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world." So this test is for unbelievers, not Christians. And so Christians are different. Though we walk on this earth, our dwelling place is in heaven. We have been seated in the heavenly places in Jesus in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6, where it says, "And raised us up together and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus." So we do not dwell on the earth. Our life is hidden in Jesus in Colossians chapter 3, verse 3, where it says, "For you died and your life is hidden with Christ in God." So keep you from the hour of trial. Does this imply an escape before the great tribulation, or does it promise protection in it? Each side believes this passage easily supports their position. And so those who believe that the church will be here on earth during this time of great tribulation are going to focus on Jesus' command to persevere. And they say that the context demands seeing this as protection that enables the faithful to persevere in that period. Those who believe that Jesus will come for his church before this time of great tribulation will note that the protection is promised from the very hour of trial, not just the trial itself. They're also going to point to a worldwide, inescapable cataclysm that's predicted in the great tribulation. In Matthew 24, verse 21, will say, "For then there will be great tribulation, such has not been seen since the beginning of the world until this time, no, nor ever shall be." It's also in Revelation chapter 6, 8 through 9, and 16. So, however, persevere is in the past tense, showing it's something that Christians had already done before the hour of trial, which had not yet come upon the world. The promise is a reward for past perseverance, not the equipping to persevere in the future. So as far as the Philadelphian church was concerned, the rapture of the church was presented to them as an imminent hope. In addition, the ones tested by this hour of trial are not primarily believers, but those who dwell on the earth, whose home is this earth, who are not citizens of heaven. Philippians chapter 3, verse 20 will say, "For our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ." All right, verse 11. "Behold, I am coming quickly. Hold fast what you have, that no one may take your crown." So first, the church in Philadelphia must remember that Jesus is coming quickly, and they must prepare for his coming. And so the expression quickly is to be understood as something which is sudden and unexpected, not necessarily immediate. And so hold fast what you have. The church at Philadelphia must not depart from its solid foundation, as described in Revelation chapter 3, verse 8. They had evangelistic opportunity, reliance on God, and faithfulness to Jesus. And these things can and must continue among the church in Philadelphia, but it will only happen as they hold fast what they have. If they fail to hold fast, their crown might be given to another. The idea is not that it might be stolen by another, but it's given. And this is not a crown of royalty given because of royal birth. This is a crown of victory. Jesus encouraged his saints to finish their course with victory, to play the second half just as strongly as they played the first half. And so never forget that the man who most likely to steal your crown is yourself. Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it are all the issues of life, in Proverbs 4, verse 23. So you are in no greater danger from anyone or anything than from yourself. Verse 12, he who overcomes, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go out no more. And I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which comes down out of heaven from my God, and I will write on him my new name. So overcomers were told that they would be as a pillar in the temple of my God. Pillars were pictures of strength, stability, and dignified beauty. The ancient city of Philadelphia suffered from frequent earthquakes, so when a building collapsed in an earthquake, often all that remained standing were the huge pillars. So Jesus is offering us the same strength to remain standing in him when everything around us crumbles. And so the pillar holds up the building. The only thing supporting the pillar is the foundation. True pillars in the church support the church, and they look to Jesus as their support foundation. So he shall go out no more. The overcomer would have a place of permanence and stability with God, in contrast to an uncertain place in this world. And so the overcomer also received many names of God, the New Jerusalem, and the new name of Jesus. These names are marks of identification because they show who we belong to. They are marks of intimacy because they show that we are privileged to know him in ways that others are not. And this all works together well with the image of a pillar. In the ancient world, having a special inscribed pillar added to one of the temples sometimes honored a faithful city servant or a distinguished priest. Philadelphia honored its illustrious sons by putting their names on the pillars of its temples so that all who came to worship might see and remember. Verse 13, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. So we all want to hear the praise and encouragement Jesus gave to the church at Philadelphia. If we will be like this church, we must stay on their foundation, which was Jesus' name and Jesus' word. We must also depend on their source of strength, which was Jesus and not themselves. Verse 14, and to the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write. So the church of the Laodiceans. Laodicea was an important, wealthy city with a significant Jewish population. Like other cities in the region, it was a center for Caesar worship and the worship of the healing god Asclepius. And there was a famous temple of Asclepius in Laodicea, with more famous medical school connected with that temple. After an earthquake devastated the region in 60 AD, Laodicea refused imperial help to rebuild the city, successfully relying on their own resources. They didn't need outside help, they didn't ask for it, and they didn't want it. Laodicea was too rich to accept help from anyone. Tacitus, the Roman historian, tells us that Laodicea arose from the ruins by the strength of her own resources and with no help from us. So Laodicea was also noted as a commercial center, and some of its goods were exported all over the world. It's frequently noted that Laodicea prided itself on three things: financial wealth, an extensive textile industry, and a popular eye salve which was exported around the world. One of their problems was a poor water supply that made Laodicea vulnerable to attack through siege. If an enemy army surrounded that city, they had insufficient water supplies in the city, and the supplies coming into the city could be easily cut off. Therefore, the leaders of Laodicea were always accommodating to any potential enemy, and always wanted to negotiate and compromise instead of fight. So their main water supply came on a 6-mile aqueduct from a hot springs in Hierapolis. Because the water came from hot springs, it arrived unappeasingly lukewarm. And so the church at Laodicea is mentioned by Paul in a somewhat unfavorable light in Colossians chapter 2, verse 1, where he says, "For I want you to know what a great conflict I have for you and those in Laodicea." It's also in Colossians chapter 4, verse 16, where he says, "Now when this epistle is read among you, see that it's read also in the church of the Laodiceans, and that you likewise read the epistle from Laodicea." So, verse 14, "These things says the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God." So Jesus is the Amen, the so be it, the it is done. As 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20 will say, "For all the promises of God in him are yes, and in him amen." Jesus is the personification and the affirmation of the truth of God. And so this is Jesus, the faithful and true witness, and this was a contrast to the Laodiceans, who will be shown to be neither faithful nor true. And the idea behind the word for beginning, the ancient Greek word ark, is that of a ruler, source, or origin, not of first in sequential order. This verse does not teach that Jesus was the first being created, but that he is the ruler, source, and origin of all creation. It has the idea of first in prominence more than first in sequence. Verse 15 and 16, "I know your works, that you are neither cold nor hot. I could wish that you were cold or hot. So then, because you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will vomit you out of my mouth." So this picture of lukewarmness would immediately connect with the Christians of Laodicea, because the water they drank every day was lukewarm. Jesus said, "Just as the water that you drink is disgustingly lukewarm, you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot." So in this spiritual sense, lukewarmness is a picture of indifference and compromise, something permeating our culture today. It tries to play the middle, too hot to be cold and too cold to be hot. In trying to be both things, they end up being nothing, except to hear the words, "I will vomit you out of my mouth." Did Jesus mean to say that these Christians were intrinsically cold but warmed up by their religious trappings, or that they were essentially hot but cooled down by their apathy and self-reliance? Both are possible, but since he spoke to his church, there is an emphasis on the latter. And has there been a greater curse upon the earth than empty religion? Is there any soul harder to reach than the one who has just enough of Jesus to think that they have enough? The church of Laodicea exemplifies empty religion, and tax collectors and harlots were more open to Jesus than the scribes and Pharisees. So Satan will have us any way he can get us, but he prizes a lukewarm religionist far above a cold-hearted sinner. And what Jesus wanted to change in them and us, as much as anything, is the deceptive playing of the middle, sitting on the fence, trying to please both the world and Jesus. "So I could wish that you were cold or hot" also points to another aspect of lukewarmness as a picture of uselessness. Hot water heals, cold water refreshes, but lukewarm water is useless for either purpose. It's as if Jesus said, "If you were hot or cold, I could do something with you. Because you are neither, I will do nothing." The lukewarm Christian has enough of Jesus to satisfy a craving for religion, but not enough for eternal life. So the thief on the cross was cold towards Jesus and clearly saw his need. John was hot towards Jesus and enjoyed a relationship of love. But Judas was lukewarm, following Jesus enough to be considered a disciple, yet not giving his heart over to Jesus in fullness. So deep down, there is no one more miserable than a lukewarm Christian. They have too much of the world to be happy in Jesus, and too much of Jesus to be happy in the world. But how could Jesus say, "I could wish that you were cold"? We know his deepest desire is that they be hot, with an on-fire love for him. And you can see Revelation chapter 3, verse 19, where the word zealous is associated with the same word hot. Yet if they would not be hot, Jesus preferred cold rather than lukewarm. So the Lord is saying, if instead of being lukewarm, you were so cold that should feel the coldness, then the very feeling of your need might drive you to true warmth. But now you're in lukewarmness, you have just enough to protect yourselves against the feeling of need. So lukewarm, and such prayers mock God, and such lives will turn people away from Jesus. And so the name Laodicea means rule of the people. This church well represents a church run by majority rule instead of God. Its name designates it as a church of mob rule, the democratic church in which everything is swayed or decided by popular opinion, clamor, and voting. And this is reflected in Jesus' address to the church of the Laodiceans, in verse 14. For the other churches, it was the church of Ephesus in chapter 2, verse 1, or the church in Smyrna in Revelation chapter 2, verse 8. You compare that with the church of the Laodiceans. Or you can see the church in Sardis in Revelation chapter 3, verse 1. But here it is the church of the Laodiceans. So we might even say that lukewarmness is the natural tendency of our fallen natures. And here's some descriptions of a lukewarm church. They have prayer meetings, but there are few present, for they like the quiet evenings at home. When more attend the meetings, they are still very dull, for they do their praying very deliberately and are afraid of being too excited. They are content to have all things done decently and in order, but vigor and zeal are considered to be vulgar. They may have schools, Bible classes, preaching rooms, and all sorts of agencies, but they might as well be without them, for no energy is displayed and no good comes of them. They have deacons and elders who are excellent pillars of the church. If the chief quality of pillars be to stand still and exhibit no motion or emotion, the pastor does not fly very far in preaching the everlasting gospel, and he certainly has no flame of fire in his preaching. The pastor may be a shining light of eloquence, but he certainly is not a burning light of grace, setting men's hearts on fire. Everything is done in half-hearted, listless, dead and alive way. It's as if it did not matter whether it was done or not. And things are respectably done. The rich families are not offended. The skeptical party is consolated. And the good people are not quite alienated. So things are made pleasant all around. And the right things are done. But as to doing them with all your might, soul, and strength, a Laodicean church has no notion of what that means. And they are not so cold as to abandon their work or to give up their meetings or for prayer or to reject the gospel. So they're neither hot for the truth nor they're hot for conversions, nor are they hot for holiness. They're not fiery enough to burn the stubble of sin, nor zealous enough to make Satan angry, nor fervent enough to make a living sacrifice of themselves upon the altar of their God. They are neither cold nor hot. So how are churches in the mouth of Jesus? They are in his mouth because they spread his word, and they are in his mouth because he prays for them constantly. So what a terrible thing in either of these ways to be expelled from the mouth of Jesus. Verse 17, because you say, I am rich, have become wealthy, and have need of nothing, and do not know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. So the church at Laodicea lacked a sense of spiritual poverty. They looked at their spiritual condition and they said they were rich. They looked again and said they were wealthy. They looked a third time and said, we have need of nothing. They were the opposite of blessed are the poor in spirit that Jesus spoke of in Matthew chapter 5, verse 3. So the Laodiceans put their trust in material prosperity, in outward luxury, and in physical health. They felt that they didn't need anything. The loss of a sense of need, as the drowsiness that besets a freezing man, is fatal. And so it wasn't that the church at Laodicea wasn't spiritually poor. They were simply blind to it. Jesus looked at their spiritual condition and said, wretched. He looked again and said, miserable. And a third time he looked and said, poor. He looked again and said, blind. A final time Jesus looked and saw that they were spiritually naked. And so the city of Laodicea was famous for its wealth, but the Christians of the city were spiritually wretched, miserable, and poor. Laodicea was famous for its healing eye salve, but the Christians of the city were spiritually blind. Laodicea was famous for its fine clothing, but the Christians of the city were spiritually naked. And the contrasts are shocking. The contrast between what they think they are and what they really are. The contrast between what they see and what Jesus sees. And the contrast between the wealth and affluence of their city and their own spiritual bankruptcy. And you are. This wasn't just an opinion of Jesus. Spiritually speaking, they were wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. What Jesus saw in them was more important than how they saw themselves. The church in Smyrna thought they were poor, but when they were really rich, in chapter 2, verse 9. But the church of the Laodiceans believed that they were rich when they were really poor. So we might say that it all began with their spiritual blindness. If you're blind, you can't look at yourself and see that you're wretched, miserable, poor, and naked. Mental darkness is worse than the loss of sight, but a loss of spiritual vision is even worse. And so the Laodiceans are typical of the modern world, which revels in that which the natural eye can see, but is untouched by the gospel and does not see beyond the veil of the material to the unseen and real eternal spiritual riches. Verses 18 through 20. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire, that you may be rich, and white garments, that you may be clothed, that the shame of your nakedness may not be revealed, and anoint your eyes with eye salve, that you may see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten, therefore be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and dine with him, and he with me. So the change in the Laodiceans had to begin with understanding their spiritual poverty. As long as we believe we can meet the need for wealth, clothing, or sight ourselves, we can never receive them from Jesus. We must seek these things from Jesus instead of relying on them ourselves. And if they received from Jesus his riches, his gold, beautifully refined in the fire, then they may be rich, spiritually speaking. And so if they received from Jesus the pure righteous covering he gives, they would be clothed, and no longer would the shame of your nakedness be revealed. The merchants of Laodicea were famous for a glossy black wool that they used to make beautiful garments. Jesus says, I know the beautiful black that the world can clothe you in, but I have white garments that you may be clothed. And anoint your eyes with eye salve. If they receive from Jesus the healing of their spiritual sight, they would then be able to see. So buy from me. So how can we buy these things from Jesus? We don't earn them through our good works. Instead, Jesus would say, all this self-sufficiency must be expended in the labor of getting from me, Jesus, these absolute necessaries. So with a sharp rebuke, had Jesus lost his love for his errant church? Not at all. Jesus' great love was expressed in his rebuke. It is, in fact, God's final punishment to leave a man alone. So the word for love in as many as I love is not agape, but phileo. Jesus' heart to this church is, even though I rebuke you and I chasten you, I'm still your friend and I love you deeply as my friend. Yet upon a church that has sunk so low as Laodicea, the risen Lord still showers his love. And so the word here for love is a very choice one. It's one that signifies an intense personal affection. So therefore be zealous and repent. So he commanded them to make a decision to repent and to consent and to continue in zeal. Turn your way, Jesus said. Don't look to your own riches and resources because they're really bankrupt. Turn around and look to me. So the ancient Greek word zealous comes from the same word as hot in Revelation chapter 3, verse 16. Though Jesus detested their lukewarmness, he would really rather them be hot with zeal rather than cold. So we need to make our life following Jesus not just a hobby or an occasional activity. This goes against the spirit of our age, which was long ago expressed by a famous Englishman when he read a sermon by G.W.E. Russell. Things have come to a pretty pass when religion is allowed to invade the sphere of private life. So trap on the believer's repentance will say, this is the rainbow, which if God sees shining in our hearts, he will never drown our souls. So Jesus gave this lukewarm church the great invitation. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. You'll notice where he is. He's outside the church, outside knocking, asking to be let in. So he knocked at their door, asking entry to come and dine with them in the sense of a sharing warm, intimate time. It only happens as we respond to his knock, but the promise is made to all, if anyone hears my voice. The idea of Jesus at the door applies to the sinner and to the saint just the same. Jesus wants to come in to us and dine with us in the sense of having a deep, meaningful relationship. And I stand at the door. Sadly, Jesus stood on the outside knocking to get in. If the church at Philadelphia was the church of the open door, then Laodicea had the church of the excluded Jesus. And so I stand at the door and knock if anyone hears my voice and opens the door. So this statement of Jesus expressed a profound mystery. Why did Jesus stand outside the door? Why did he knock? Why did he wait until someone opens the door? He had every right to just break down the door or enter some other way on his own accord, but he didn't. The sovereign, omnipotent Jesus lowered himself to work out his eternal plan by wooing the cooperation of the human heart. The occupant must open the door. That is, he must repent of his pride and self-sufficiency, his human wisdom, and his cowardly neutrality. So Christ stands, waits long at the door of the sinner's heart. He knocks, uses judgments, mercies, reproofs, exhortations to induce sinners to repent and turn to him. He lifts up his voice, calls loudly by his word, and ministers in spirit. And Jesus comes to the door as the lover in the Song of Solomon. And this is a similar to, or perhaps a quotation of, Song of Solomon, chapter 5, verse 2. It is the voice of my beloved. He knocks, saying, open for me, my sister, my love. So the key to opening the door is to first hear his voice. When we give attention to what Jesus says, then we can be rescued from our own lukewarmness and enter into a zealous relationship with him. And so I will come into him. This is a glorious promise. If we open the door, he will come in. He's not going to ring the bell and run away. He promised to come in and then to dine with the believer. When Jesus said dine with him, he spoke of a specific meal known as the deep non. The deep non was a main meal of the day and was a leisurely affair, not a hurried snack. This speaks of fellowship. It speaks of a depth to a relationship. So supper, or deep non, was the main meal of that day. And so this is where Jesus wants us, in the place of fellowship with him. Everything he said to the Laodicean church up to this point must be seen in light of his loving desire for fellowship. So rebuke and chastisement are no signs of rejection from Christ, but of his abiding and pleading love, even to the lukewarm and careless. And so you'll notice, he says, if anyone, you'll notice that Jesus gave the call to individuals. He didn't say if any church, but if anyone. If we must not talk about getting the church right, we must pray for grace for each one for himself. For the text does not say if the church will open the door, but if any man hears my voice and opens the door. It must be done by individuals. The church will only get right by each man getting right. Verse 21, to him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne, as I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. So Jesus promised to the overcomer, even at Laodicea, show that we don't have to be Christians who are compromising and lukewarm. If we are, we can change and become one of Jesus' overcomers. And those who overcome the battle against indifference, compromise, and self-reliance receive a special reward. They enjoy a place with the enthroned Jesus. And this is the worst of the seven churches, and yet the most imminent of all the promises are made to it, showing that the worst may repent, finally conquer, and attain even to the highest state of glory. Verse 22, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. So few want to identify themselves with the church of Laodicea. We could much rather identify ourselves with the church at Philadelphia, but sadly, many churches today have the spirit of the Laodiceans. So we must hear what the Holy Spirit says here, because he speaks to the churches, including us. May God deliver us from the self-reliant, compromising lukewarmness that marked the church of the Laodiceans. All right, so a little something extra, putting the seven churches of Revelation into a historical perspective. Many have attempted to make sense of Revelation chapters 2 and 3 and the letters to the seven churches of Asia by taking them as a unified whole. It is significant that Jesus chose these particular seven congregations to address, though there were other churches in the region that were not written to, such as the church at Colossae. Additionally, some have pointed to the order of the letters as evidence of their significance as a broad explanation of church history in the period between the Ascension and Jesus to his return, or the ascension of Jesus to his return. So it's also interesting to note that Paul addressed seven churches as well: Rome, Corinth, Galatia, Ephesus, Colossae, Philippi, and Thessalonica. Some also note with interest that Jesus also gave seven kingdom parables. So early commentators on the book of Revelation emphasized that as seven is the number of completion and fulfillment, so Jesus and Paul wrote to seven churches as an indication that they were in fact speaking to the complete church, not just these seven congregations. Speaking to seven churches means speaking to the church in perfection, in completion and totality. As one commentator puts it, the churches of all time are comprehended in seven. So here is what some say about each of these periods as they relate to church history. So although it is by no means the dominant theme, there is a sense also in which the seven churches seem to depict the respective stages of development and change of Christ churches during the ensuing centuries. History has indeed shown such a general development through the years. He is not capricious in his selection, and there is bound to be some significance in the sequence of the seven as well as the total. All right, so let's go over this. The Church of Ephesus covers the period in church history of the Apostolic Age, and it dates before 100 AD. Smyrna will cover the period in church history, the age of persecution, and its dates will cover church history from 100 AD to 313 AD. Pergamus, which means perverted marriage, That's going to cover the period in church history, the Imperial Church Age from 313 to 590 AD. Thyatira, the Age of Papacy, from the dates of 590 to 1517 AD. Sardis was the Reformation Age from 517 to 1730. And then Philadelphia, the period in church history, is the Missionary Age. And the dates are from 1730 to 1900. And Laodicea, the Age of Apostasy, the Lukewarm Church, covers the dates from 1900 to whenever he comes. And so if Ephesian was warmth and love and labor for Christ, defection beginning with a gradual cooling of love, false professions and clergy-laity distinctions. Smyrna was a sweet and precious martyrdom, but a progression of clergy and laity distinctions and Judaizing tendencies with an increasing departure from the simplicity of the gospel. Pergamite, true faith more and more disappearing. Clericism, systemized union with the world there. Thyatirian, purple and glory for the corrupt priesthood, false prophets enthroned in a time when truth was exchanged for darkness up to the Reformation period. Sardian or Sardis, separation and return to the rule of Christ. There's many great names, but also deadness and lethargy, the Protestant centuries. Philadelphian, the closer adherence to Jesus' word, more fraternity among Christians, modern evangelical movement of the 19th century. And not so much of a description of the Laodicean church among this, along the same pattern, because some commentators would feel that it was not yet really to emerge upon the scene. Clarence Larkin, in the greatest book on dispensational truth in the world, 1918, wrote that Ephesians, the church to Ephesus, covered 70 to 170 AD, the backslidden church, Smyrna from 170 to 312 AD, the persecuted church, Pergamite, 312 to 606 AD, the licentious church, Thyatira, 606 to 1520, the lax church, Sardis, 1520 to 1750, the dead church, Philadelphian, 1750 to 1900, the favored church, and Laodicean, 1900 to the end, a lukewarm church. And so Chuck Smith will say the Ephesians were the early church up to the death of John. Smyrna was the second of 4th centuries Roman persecutions. Pergamite beginning at 316, development of the church-state system under Constantine. Thyatira, the unrepentant, unfaithful church destined to go through the Great Tribulation. The Sardis, the dead Protestantism. Philadelphia, the faithful church of the last days. And Laodicean, the apostate church of the last days. So evaluating these interpretations. This historical approach to the seven churches of Revelation is useful if these periods are seen as broad, imprecise descriptions of the church through history, allowing for generous periods of overlap. For example, it seems that the last four churches will persist until the coming of Jesus. And you can see Revelation chapter 2, verse 25, chapter 3, verse 3, chapter 3, verse 11, and chapter 3, verse 20. Which will say, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in with him and dine with him, and he with me." If one accepts these seven letters as descriptive of the flow of church history, it does not require that we see them as exclusive, rigidly sequential ages. It's good to remember that if these letters are a prophecy of the course of church history, this is their secondary significance. First and foremost, the letters are written to real existing first century congregations and to all who have an ear to hear, which is every human. And since there is nothing directly said by Christ to require or even suggest such a prophetic application, a literalistic approach to the study of Revelation cannot place much emphasis on it. As well, we must remember that every age has some characteristics of all seven churches. Though certain historical periods are marked by the conditions spoken of in these letters, we could never really say that only one letter applies only to us of our age. And so there are Protestant Papists, there are Papist Protestants, sectarian anti-secretarians, partyists who are not schismatics, holy ones in the midst of abounding defection and apostasy, and unholy ones in the midst of the most earnest and active faith, light in dark places and darkness in the midst of light. So we need to hear what the Spirit says to the churches in the plural sense, not just to one church. If anyone is confused or overwhelmed by that last little bit going over all the seven churches, just go to the website at taylorbiblestudy.com and look at the written Bible commentary. It'll be in the notes under Revelation chapter 3, and that'll provide a little bit of a better visual detail for you.